Impacting lives, choose life, sharing love to everyone. Impacting lives, choose life, sharing joy through the gospel of Jesus, gospel of Jesus, gospel of Jesus Christ.
We are the elements of Judah tribe. We praise no matter what we are going through. We stand firm on the word of God. Any other words are lies. We boldly confess. We are the overcomers through the blood of the Lamb. We are secure because God is our Father, Jesus is our Savior, and the Holy Spirit is our Comforter. We have life in its full abundance. We will learn from our experiences, and we will never be the same. We are loved by God. We live at peace with others. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice in the God who gives us hope. Rejoice in the God who gives us peace. We rejoice in the God who gives us love. Rejoice in the God who gives us everything that we need. Because of Christ, we are set free. Whom the Son set free is free indeed. I do not put my trust in man. I do not put my trust in flesh. I put my trust in God. I walk by faith. I live in faith and not by sight. I'm responsible for my decisions and my choices. I make a decision to choose and worship the Lord. I choose blessings. I choose the word of God. I choose wisdom. I thank you, Lord, that I am responsible for making my own way prosperous and I have good success. I have faith to speak to mountains and they shall obey me. My heart will never depart from you. I will always serve God. Thank you, Lord, for prosperity. I will flourish because I live in the days of the Messiah. I have prosperity and I have good success because of God's grace in Jesus' name. I declare that I, like Enoch, have a testimony that I please God through my faith. Because of my faith, I am pleasing to God, and He will reward me because I seek Him diligently. By faith, I will sojourn in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles which Isaiah and Jacob, as I am an heir of the same promise. I will forsake my bondage that seeks to entrap me, looking forward by faith and setting my eyes on Him who is invisible. I decree and declare that by faith I will walk through my trials on dry ground, and my enemies will drown. I will encircle the immovable walls in my life, and my faith, those walls will fall down. Like Rahab, I will receive the men of God with peace. I will not perish with those who do not believe. I will subdue kingdoms, rain down righteousness, obtain promises, and stop the mountains of lions because of my faith. I declare that I will not only receive a good testimony of faithfulness, but I will also receive all that God has promised. I am established and I am anointed by God. I activate my mustard seed of faith and say to this mountain of sickness and disease in my life, be removed and go to another place. Nothing will be impossible to me. Because you have anointed me, I have faith, and I do not doubt that I can speak to any illness. Curse is not at the root and cause it to dry up, and it will die in the name of Jesus. Just as you did to the fig tree, I also know that I will tell to this mountain of sickness that is in my way to be moved and be cast into the sea, and it shall be done in Jesus' name. I declare that I have uncommon great faith in the power of Jesus Christ, faith that cannot be found anywhere else. Just as Jesus stood in the boat and spoke to the storm, I too can stand in the midst of the storms in my life and rebuke the winds and the waves to command calmness in my life. My faith overrides all fears. I will not sink into faithlessness and doubt. I will be upheld by the mighty hand of God. I pray as your anointed disciples pray. Increase my faith, O God. I will not be weak in faith. Like Abraham, I declare that my body is not dead, but alive to birth out the gifts and the anointing God has set aside for me. I will not stagger at the promise of God through unbelief, but I will stand strong in the faith, giving glory to God. My faith increases. The more I hear and hear by His word, my faith increases. Even though I go through many common trials in this life, God, I declare that you are faithful. You will not allow me to face things beyond what I can stand. You have ordered a way of escape for me, and through your strength, I can bear it. I walk by faith and not by sight. I declare that I feel the substance and see the evidence, the things that I have faith for. You are Lord of all, and the worlds are framed by your very words. You speak into existence unseen things. I see through the eyes of faith the promise of things afar off. I am persuaded at their reality, and I embrace them, knowing that I am stronger and pilgrim on this earth. I will stand firm and not waver. I will come boldly before God, asking in faith, in the mighty name of Jesus. Bless your people this day, O God. Bless our going out and our coming in. Bless everything that concerns us. Heal our heart and show yourself strong. Bless everything that we need, God. Give us wisdom and understanding and strength. As we go through this day, as we go through this week, we overcome the enemy every time. We overcome dark situations every time. We overcome circumstances every time. And we are healed. We are strong. We are champions. We are overcomers through the blood of the Lamb. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Yeah.
Maker of heaven and earth. Jesus, hallelujah. To pour my love on you like oil upon your feet. Good morning, everyone, and welcome again to Elements of Judah Tribe. We are so excited to have you with us, and it is indeed my honor and my privilege to share with you what God has placed upon my heart. And so I pray that as I speak, that God is going to take his word, and it's going to, your eyes are going to be open, your hearts are going to be ready to receive the engrafted word, that when the Spirit comes, he's going to take it and he's just going to break it apart in the simplicity of it, and it's going to become so practical that you can walk this thing out as an overcomer. And so I want to continue from what Pastor Brian has been teaching for the past couple of sessions, which is dominion. And just to do a very simple recap, it's his key scripture was from Genesis chapter 1 verse 26, and he spoke about dominion being a process and not a one-time thing. He also spoke about dominion being something that you have to be consistent about. It is not a one-time thing, but it's a process of transformation. It is a process of evolution. It is a process of growth, intentional growth. And today we are going to continue along that same line, and I am going to talk about the 3D principles of dominion. And I really pray that it blesses your heart. It's three simple steps. I'm not going to use much scriptures, but I am going to use stories, characters in the Bible to show you how it is we can have dominion in every aspect of our lives. So let's get started. The first thing I want to talk about, the first principle, is called the devotional. Now, the devotional aspect of dominion is the personal aspect, that personal one-on-one aspect of yourself and God. Let me explain what I mean by devotional. When we look at the devotional aspect of dominion, we are looking at self-governance. And Pastor Brian would have touched on this on his last session. So we are looking at our individual lives, our internal self-governance. The first thing we want to make note of is you cannot rule in greater things if we have not learned to manage our internal lives. What do I mean by our internal lives? For example, let us take an everyday life. So we get up in the morning. What is your routine when you get up in the morning? Is your day planned? Do you have set time for prayer and the word? How do you structure your day? Those simple things are internal self-governance, where somebody else external to you doesn't have to come and tell you, Pastor Sophie, you need to do this, you need to do X, you need to do Y. No, you know within yourself, these are the things that I need to get done. These are the areas that I need to work on. These are the areas that I need to improve. So when we talk about the devotional aspect, we are actually talking about internal self-governance. And I want to give you two very basic examples of internal self-governance. I once heard U.S. Navy Admiral, he was saying that the first thing that he does when he gets off of his bed after devotions is that he makes his bed. But the making of his bed actually sets the tone for the entire day, because that is one task completed, and one task completed will lead to a second task completed, and would lead to a third task, and before you know it, at the end of the day, you would have done a series of completed tasks. And when you didn't have a good day, let's say by chance, you know, you had some rough waters, you had some challenging times, you would have come home to a bed that is completely made. And I thought about that and I said, you know what? As simple as it is, as simple as that principle of making your bed, it says a lot about who you are. There's another example, and it's called, I think it's called the trolley principle or the trolley effect. So you know when you go to the supermarket, you use a trolley or a grocery cart, and there is a sign outside that says, after use, place cart here. Now, the thing about it is, There is nobody looking at me when I go to the supermarket. There is nobody checking to see if I'm putting the cart back in the appropriate place. But it says something about who I am. It says something about my character. It says something about my morals. It says something about my ethics. When nobody is looking, I still do the right thing. And this is a scripture verse that comes to mind. The Bible says, I do always those things that please the Father. Now, if I take off the word always, it's still a good verse, you know. It will be, I do those things that please the Father. But that word always connotates whether somebody sees me or somebody doesn't see me. Whether my pastor is there or my pastor isn't there. Whether it's a small task or a big task. I do always those things that please the Father. So when it comes to the devotional aspect of dominion, we have got to learn to take charge of our own sphere. We have got to learn to take charge of our emotions, our behaviors, our attitudes. And I want to read something for you that I found to be so very, very interesting. And it talks about being the devotional aspect of ministry. We can look at the big things. So you know, when we look at the things that affect us, that we need to change: frustration, anger, jealousy, hate, fear, malice, lust. Those are the things that we can see readily. And in the devotional phase, because we spend time in prayer, because we spend time in fasting, because we spend time in the Word, because we spend time in worship, all of those things are tools that we use to have dominion over our lives. Because we're doing that, it's easy, or seems to be easier, to rectify. But then there are some subtle things that come in and they creep in, and we don't always know about it. We are not always aware of it. What are some of the subtle things that come in? We can talk about materialistic things. We could talk about timidity, self-will. We could be in excessive competitiveness, anxiety, busyness. We're constantly negative, unhappy. We dislike things. We murmur, we complain. All of those things are subtle things that can actually come in. And when they come in, we don't have dominion over this. So when trials and situation comes, when challenges come, sometimes it shows up things in our lives that we need to have dominion over. One of the things is our mindsets, the way that we think, the way that we view ourselves, the way that we speak, the way that we carry about ourselves. All of these things fall under the devotional aspect of dominion. I hope you're understanding what I'm saying. I hope this is simple enough for you. So I want you to know, you cannot go on to the next phase. You cannot go on to the next principle if you have not mastered. If you have not mastered and make alive or apply on a daily basis that devotional principle of dominion. So as I said, we're doing the 3D principle. Of course, this is devotional. And I'm going to use, at the end when I'm wrapping up, I'm going to give you a couple biblical examples of persons who would have had to go through the different phases and how they would have overcome each phase. Alright, so we've done devotional. Let's look at the other 3D principle, which is the domestic. The domestic, when you have mastered your internal sphere, your immediate space, your home environment, your bedroom environment. I remember my father was preaching one time and he said, if you cannot take care of a 10 by 10 bedroom, don't expect God to give you a 30 by 40 house. So we're going to look at the 30 by 40 house as the domestic, which is it's external to you, but just outside of your doors. So that would be your community and nationalistic dominion. How does my community see me? How am I influencing my community? How am I taking dominion over the things that I have no control over. So let me give you an example. Let's say you live in an extended family. Not all of your family members are born again believers, but you are. What is your response to them when they say, "Oh, I know you, you're just playing holy, you're just a church girl, you're just going to church because of this," and they ridicule your belief? What is your response? How do you take dominion over that? How do you take dominion over your job, over your career, where you work with your colleagues, with your employer? That is the domestic. So it's not on a global platform, as we would get to the other one, but this is just outside of your immediate sphere. And I want to say to you, when you have mastered the devotional aspect, the domestic aspect, even though it would come with its own challenges, with its own circumstances and upheavals, because you've learned to master your emotions, because you've learned to master your self-control and your self-will, and you've brought that will not in subjection to what you believe, but you've brought that will in subjection to Christ. Because our measurement is not ourselves, our standard of measurement is not our neighbor, it's not another family, our standard of measurement is Christ. So we want to live like Christ. We want to exhibit Christ's characteristics. We want to exhibit his behavioral patterns. We want to live like him, talk like him, walk like him. And that's what the Bible says, "Be thou an example of the brethren." So when you stand, you are an ambassador. You are a representative of the kingdom of heaven. So I have got to learn, you have got to learn to master each of these principles. So we've got to master the devotional, and now at this stage in the domestic, you've got to master that as well. Now, the domestic is a little bit different, and the reason I'm saying that is because, as I said before, these are some situations that you have no control over. You have no control over how your employer treats you, how your work colleagues treat you. What you have control over is your response to them. So dominion, me having dominion, would mean me showing forth a Christ-like attitude in that domestic sphere. How do my community leaders see me? Can they call on me? Can they say, "You know, Sister X is such a wonderful person. Every time I look at her, there is a grace that flows. Every time I speak to him, I feel as he speaks with such wisdom." You know, these are things that we need to look at. Can I influence? Can I be an influence to my peers, my colleagues, my friends, my neighbors? Those are the things that we have to ask ourselves. So we looked at the devotional. We looked at the domestic. All right, the last thing that we want to look at in the 3D principle before we move to examples is the dominion principle. Yes, I know I'm using that word, but I thought it just appropriate to end the 3D principle with dominion. What does dominion, what is this aspect about? How is it different? When you have mastered and succeeded in understanding the devotional, the domestic, you're going to come to the dominion. The dominion aspect is where we begin to manage systems, where we get into places of influence, where we sit in the seat of decision making. We may sit as a member of parliament, we may sit in the law, in the judicial service, we may sit in the protective services, we may sit on education boards, we may sit in entertainment, in media, in different areas, and we sit in seats of influence. So sometimes, let me just point out here, we think that dominion is only when we get to this position. But I want to tell you, that's the last part of dominion. When you sit in these seats and you are able to have dominion, you are able to influence, you sit where laws are made, where protocols are given, where procedures are made, where systems are created, you cannot get to the dominion aspect of the 3D principles of dominion without having mastered at some level or attained at some level the domestic and the devotional. those two things are prerequisite to getting to the dominion level. So I want to say to you, when you begin to understand systems, when you begin to understand who you are, when you begin to know your identity, when you begin to walk as an ambassador of Christ, when you have displayed control over your emotions, when you have displayed control over your thoughts, when you have displayed control over what you say, what you speak, your body language, when you have done that, then God is saying, you know what, I can entrust you, my son, my daughter, to sit in these positions, to sit in the sphere of these seven mountains and begin to rule, begin to dominate, begin to master, begin to sit and make procedures. You know why? Because he knows when you sit there, you are making decisions based on the principles of the word of God, that you are not going to get there and do your own thing and be rebellious, but rather you are going to take those principles and those things and those situations that you would have overcome in the devotional and domestic phase, and you are going to bring it into the dominion stage, and you are going to rule and you are going to reign. You are going to be seated in influencing positions that will be able to tip the scales, not just in your favor, but in Christ's. And I think that is key for us to understand. So let me just recap. We have the devotional, which is your personal life. You have the domestic, which is your community and your immediate sphere, your work environment, etc. And then you have your dominion, which is you take part in systems, you rule in global platforms. God is not going to put you on a global platform if you have not mastered or attained to achieving dominion in your devotional life. We have got to change our mindsets. And I think Pastor Brian said it, changing of a mindset is key to understanding, but not just understanding, being able to access what we have. Being able to access what we have. So how do we, and I said it before and I want to reiterate it, how do we have dominion in our sphere? And I want to tell you, this is an ongoing process. You don't have dominion over devotional today and you move on and don't come back to this. Having dominion in your devotional, in your domestic, and in your dominion spheres is an everyday thing. Nothing that you face in life is going to always be the same. You're going to face new challenges, new uphill climbs, new battles, new warfare, and you have to know that every day I must cover all three areas. All three areas. I must constantly be in prayer. I must constantly be in the word. I must constantly be fasting. I must constantly be in worship. Those are the tools. Those are the weapons that you are going to use to develop your skill. So as you journey through life and you come up on different areas, different life circumstances, you are going to know how to have dominion. That's what we're about. God has given us dominion. There is a quote I want to read to you from Dr. Miles Monroe. And he says, to be given dominion means to be established as a sovereign, kingly ruler, master, governor, responsible for reigning over a designated territory with the inherent authority to represent and embody as a symbol the territory, resources, and all that constitutes that kingdom. So when Dr. Miles Monroe spoke about territory here, usually we get the impression that it is a piece of land. You know, like if I am ruling over Trinidad or Barbados or America. That's not what he's talking about alone. When it says ruling our territory, it is talking about mastering every area of our environment. This temple, this body is a territory. So what do I need to do to master this territory? I need to bring my thoughts into subjection to Christ. I need to bring my will, my emotions, my intellect into subjection to Christ. I need to bring all of who I am in subjection to Christ. So that is the devotional. What is the territory in the domestic? What is my relationship with those on the outside, my colleagues, as I said before? And I know it is repetitive, I'm saying it over and over, but I really want it to sink into your spirit that you've got to master, you've got to take charge of your environment, of your territory. God is not going to give you rule over big things if we can't be faithful in little things. So I want to say that to you, learn to have dominion in little things. If you are on the maintenance committee and you have to clean the church every Saturday for service, then have dominion and do it with the right spirit. Don't say, well, Sister Jack didn't do this and Brother John didn't do this, and we murmur and we complain. So what you are doing, that is a domestic situation, as a domestic principle, because you're dealing outside of your internal with the church, but your response to it comes from a devotional aspect. How have I mastered that? So yes, we want to master those things. And then you get to the dominion level. And I want to tell you that the dominion level may not happen on an everyday basis, but your devotional will, your domestic will. So those two areas, while the dominion sounds great, we may not all attain where we are all going to be sitting on keyboards of directors and this board and the education board, etc. But whatever our sphere of influence, that is what we want to master. All right. Another thing I want to mention here is our metron of grace. Now, the word metron simply means a sphere of influence. All right, so you would have heard me use that word before. In the 3D principle, your metron of grace allows you areas of functionality. If you are not called for a specific area, you cannot have dominion in it. And I'm not just talking about if you're called to be a worship leader, a pastor, an evangelist, or an apostle. Those things are part of it. But if you try to fit into an area that God has not called you to be, what you're going to find is that you're going to find yourself becoming frustrated. You're going to find yourself becoming angry and disappointed. So I want to say to you that you have got to know your metron of grace, where you are functioning. When you learn that, when you learn your role, your responsibilities, who you are not going to be in competition. Competition causes your dominion power and authority to fall. So we have got to learn where we are, what God has called us for, what we have been preordained to do. So that way, when we begin to function in the devotional, in the domestic, and in the dominion, guess what? We are going to nail it. We are going to actually have dominion in practical ways. So before I wrap up, I want to talk about Peter. And we all know Peter. Peter was the cuss bud, as they say. Peter would say whatever he wanted to say. Peter would speak before he thought. Peter was the one that drew the sword and cut off the high priest's ears. This was Peter. But then we saw Peter in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. What happened with Peter that moved Peter from being, as we say, brash and rash and not having dominion, to being able to stand up and speak in dominion and address a global platform? Let's chat a little bit about that. So Peter, what would have happened is he would have learned. When he came to Jesus, he would have learned. He would have denied Jesus. He would have cursed. He would have done all of these things. But there was something about Peter that you can't help but love Peter. You just can't help but love Peter. Even though Peter was brash and rash and he would do things without thinking and he was emotional and he would respond but act out, there was something about Peter that persevered. So what Peter would have done, life would have taught him how to speak, how to live, how to talk, how to interact. He would have come, even through his denial of Jesus Christ, you would still find him being able to say, you know what, I'm going to walk on the water. He would sink thereafter, but there was something about Peter that pushed him. So what Peter would have done, Peter would have mastered the devotional. He would have mastered the domestic. He would have had to learn until it brought him to Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit fell and everybody around thought they was drunk. And they said there were men from Crete, there were men from here, there were Jewish men. I mean, there were languages were scattered, and he was able to stand up on that platform and speak. This is the same Peter that we initially called brash and rash. This is Peter speaking on a global platform. So I want to say to you, I want to encourage you to learn in every aspect of your life. Learn the things that you have to. Everything that we go through, our dominion is connected to our purpose. Everything that life brings our way is to teach us a lesson. So instead of saying, when a situation pops up, why me, Lord? Say, Lord, what am I needing to learn here? How fast can I learn this? I need to have dominion over this situation. So I want to say to you in a quick recap, the three principles that we spoke about would be the devotional, which is your internal self-governance, your domestic, which is your community and your immediate sphere of influence, and then your dominion, which is on global platforms and systems. I want to encourage you, I really want to encourage you this morning to begin to have dominion. Comes with character building. It's going to send situations to you. He's going to send things into your life that is out there, or when you reach or at level to just flop. You're not going to say, oh my God, as we say in Trinidad, you're not going to run around like a chicken with no head. But because you've understood who you are, because you've mastered your emotions, because you've mastered the relationship you have with your peers, your colleagues, your community, when you stand on a global platform, you stand as a true ambassador. You stand as a true representative of Christ in the earth. And God is going to entrust upon you the responsibility of bringing the kingdom of heaven into earth, because you would have done it in the smaller areas. So when you are put on a large platform, he knows very well that you are going to do that. He knows very well that the task that is ahead of you, you are going to succeed, you are going to have dominion, you are going to take charge, you are going to rule that territory. So I want to say to you this morning, in everything that we go through, in everything that we face, ask God, Father, as your daughter, help me as your son to have dominion. Help me to master these things. Help me to master areas where I have shortcomings. Show me. Ask him, show me, Lord, areas that I need to improve in. Show me relationships that I need to fix. Show me relationships that I need to work on. Father, show me where I need to humble myself and apologize. Show me areas that I need to fix. And you know what? When we take that approach, let me tell you something. You are well on your way to having full dominion, even on a global platform. So as I close, I just want to pray with you. Father God, today in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you for your word. I want to thank you for breaking bread this morning, God. And in the simplicity of your word, I pray, God, that it would touch lives. I pray that as those listening now and thereafter, God, that it would take root and it would bear fruit, oh God. Those things that easily beset us, those stumbling blocks, those hindrances, I ask, dear God, that you remove it, that we would see clearly where you would have us to walk, that we would look at different areas of our lives, our relationships with others, our work spheres and our spheres of influence, our metron of grace, oh God, and we would take a look, God, we would look inside and say, Father, help me to have dominion. Help me to master what you need to master. Show me where I need to walk. Show me what path I should take. Father, and I pray as this word go forth, change is going to come. Mindsets are going to be changed. Perceptions are going to be changed, oh God. Strongholds are going to be broken, oh God. Those things that have us bound, that make us feel like we cannot move on, that we cannot move from where we are, that we are weak and we will never have dominion, God. Father, I thank you, oh God, that your word brings light, it brings victory, and we are an overcomer, oh God. We are victorious, and God, you said that we are destined to win, oh God. So as we go forth, oh God, may we go forth with your power, may we go forth with your strength, may we go forth in your reign, in your rule, and let us have dominion in every aspect of our lives to your honor and to your glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen. Thank you very much for joining me this morning.
Hello, how can we be successful? By living life God's way. Join me, Pastor Brian Callender, and a special guest each week as we discuss aspects of life and share nuggets with you so that you can be the best person God designed you to be. Join us every Thursday at 6 p.m. on social media as we share and challenge you to be the best that God will have you to be. Grab a friend, sit down and watch, and actively participate of what God will do as we share. God bless you.